Welcome back, students. This is the 10th and the last lecture on the chapter of interference. So in the previous lecture we had studied about the theory of Newton's rings and the formula for the diameters in the reflected light Newton's rings and transmitted light Newton's rings. In this last lecture we're going to study about a few applications of Newton's rings, three applications. Okay, so the first application of Newton's rings is to determine the wavelength of the monochromatic source which is used in the Newton's ring setup. So what meaning of monochromatic source? A source which has only one color, only one wavelength, so lambda. So this is what we are going to determine, the value of the wavelength of the monochromatic source. So what we have in the experimental setup over here is a sodium source or any monochromatic source you can take having a wavelength lambda. Lambda is unknown to us. We are going to find out the value of lambda. The light from this monochromatic source is made to pass through a collimating lens. What the lens does is it makes the beam of light parallel. Then the light is made to fall on a glass plate which is inclined at 45 degrees angle. From the glass plate, the light gets partially reflected down onto this main setup here, which consists of, we have already seen this earlier, planar convex lens kept on a flat glass plate. Between the lens and the glass plate, what is it? There is a layer of air which has a wane thickness. Thickness is zero. When the lens touches the glass plate, the thickness is zero at this contact point here, and the thickness keeps on increasing. Any direction you may go outwards, the thickness keeps on increasing. Okay, so therefore you get a circular ring pattern because of this type of nature of film. It's a radially increasing film. Therefore, the pattern which is obtained consists of alternate dark and bright rings. Then the light falls on this film. It gets reflected back upwards, passes through the glass plate, and enters the microscope. In the microscope, the rays enter here and we get either constructive or destructive interference. Depending on that, we get concentric, dark and bright rings. Okay, we've already seen the ring pattern which we obtained for Newton's rings due to reflected light and transmitted light. Now, what we are going to do here is now, we're going to try to obtain a value of this lambda. Okay, so for this, what we're going to do is, from the Newton's rings pattern, we see all those dark and bright rings, we're going to consider any two dark rings formed due to reflected light. Okay, so this derivation or this formula which we are going to derive here are assuming two things. First thing is that the pattern is obtained due to reflected light, and second thing, we are going to do measurements for dark rings, not bright rings. Okay, so these formulas are based on reflected light and for dark rings. So what are the formulas therefore? We can just a summary of the reflected light Newton's rings. This formula, so this is the formula which is important for us. We are going to use this formula. Dn square is equal to 4n lambda r upon mu. So this is the formula for the diameter of any of the nth dark ring. For the fifth dark ring, n is 5. For the tenth dark ring, n is 10, and so on. So this is the formula for the nth dark ring which we are going to use for this for the first. So what we are going to write over here is that in the Newton's rings pattern, we are going to consider any two rings. One, let us say a smaller ring, one a bigger ring. So let us say, for example, it could be fourth ring and tenth ring. Or another example could be third ring and seventh ring. Like that, any two rings, one a smaller ring and one a bigger ring. So in mathematical language, how can we write this without using numbers, mathematical generalizing, how we can write? Let us say, so for nth, n plus pth ring dark ring. So the nth and the n plus pth dark ring formed due to reflected light can we write this? So what is nth ring is one of the inner rings, smaller rings, dark ring, and n plus pth is the outer bigger ring. Well, here what is p? Here p is any positive number. For example, if you take n as 5 and you take p as 4, which will be the two rings then? The smaller ring will be the fifth ring and the bigger ring will be the ninth ring. N plus p, n is 5 and p is 4. So n is 5 and n plus p will be 9. Which two rings are we talking about therefore? The fifth ring and the ninth ring. So like this, any two rings we are talking about. So generalizing, we are talking about the nth ring and the n plus p ring, where p is any positive number. So formed due to reflected light, what are the formulas you can write based on this formula? For the nth ring, n remains n. For the n plus p ring, what is the formula for the diameter? Wherever n is there, you replace it with n plus p. So that is how we write the formulas for the diameters of the n ring and the n plus p ring. So we can, for the n ring, we can write dn square is equal to 4 n lambda r upon mu is there. But for this, for the moment, what we'll assume is that mu is 1. We are going to assume that the medium between lens and the glass plate is air. And we'll take the value of mu is 1 so that the expression becomes slightly simpler. So we're going to take mu as 1. So that's dn square is equal to 4 n lambda r upon mu. Upon mu is 1. So this is for the nth dark ring. What about the n plus p? What is the formula for the diameter of the n plus pth dark ring? It will be dn square is equal to, dn plus p square. Dn plus p square. So this is how we denote diameter of the n plus p ring. Formula for it will be what? 4 into n plus p. So wherever n is there in the formula, we replace it n plus p. Other things remain the same. So this is the formula for the diameter of the n plus p ring, the slightly bigger ring. Now, this is, let us say, equation 1 and this is equation 2. If we subtract these two equations, if we do 2 minus 1, what are we going to get? On the left hand side, we are going to get it as dn plus p square minus dn square is equal to, now if you subtract the right hand side, what is common you see is there, here there is 4n lambda r, and in this equation 2 also there will be a term 4n lambda r, which on subtracting they will cancel out, and what will remain is only, you can check it out and see, what will, your remaining will be only 4p lambda r. The 4n lambda r term from both the equations will cancel out, and this is what you will get. Now from this, what are we trying to find out? Well, our aim is to find the value of lambda. So what will be lambda from this, as per this formula? If you rewrite this formula for lambda, we can write this as lambda equal to dn plus p square minus dn square upon 4p r. So this is my formula for the wavelength of the monochromatic source, unknown wavelength of the monochromatic source. So therefore, to find lambda, what are the things we need to know, what are the things we need to measure in this experiment? So using the microscope, what are you going to do? You are going to measure the diameter of the rings. Any two rings, for example, let us say nth ring, n plus p ring. For example, 5th ring and 9th ring, or 3rd ring and 10th ring. Any two rings, smaller and bigger. So these two diameters you are going to measure. So dn plus p and dn, these two things you are going to experimentally measure. R has to be known to us. The radius of curvature of this planar convex lens, radius of curvature R has to be known. It has to be given to us. And what about the value of P? How are you going to find the value of P? So suppose you choose your rings, two rings which you are doing the measurement for. You choose the two rings as, let us say, 5th ring and 12th ring. What will be the value of P then? What is the difference between these two ring numbers? 5th and 12th. The difference is 7. So the value of P is 7. So P is nothing but the difference between the ring numbers of the two rings which you have chosen. So another example, suppose you choose, let's say, you are going to measure the diameter of the 3rd ring and let us say 9th ring. So this is your dn. The inner ring is always taken as dn, and this will be your dn plus p. Dn plus p. So if n is 3 and n plus p is 9, it implies that p is 6. So very simple to find the value of p. You just subtract the ring numbers of the two corresponding rings, and that will be the value of p. So in the measurement, what we are going to do in the experiment, we are going to measure any diameter of any two rings. So that will give us dn and dn plus p. R is given to us already, and p you are going to calculate based on whichever two rings you have chosen, ring numbers. So that's how you can find the value of wavelength lambda of the monochromatic source which you have used here. Okay, so this source which you have used, its wavelength can be determined. Now, this is the simplest way of doing this, but experimentally when you do, to reduce errors, instead of just taking and basing our answer only based on measurement of two rings, normally to get a more accurate answer, what we do is, we don't measure only two rings, we measure, let us say, four or five or six rings. Okay, so we do diameter measurement for at least five rings, and then we got a graph. Okay, so this is how we do it. So we find diameter of five rings, let us say might be the third ring, sixth ring, ninth ring, 12th ring and 15th ring. So this, let us say five rings, we measure the diameter using the traveling microscope, we square the diameters, then we plot a graph of diameter square on the y-axis versus the ring number n on the x-axis. So what are we going to do then in this case? We are going to find a slope, it's going to be a straight line. The graph of dn square versus n will be a straight line. Why? How do we know that it's going to be a straight line? If you look at this formula, right, you can look at this formula here. What does it say? Dn square is 4n lambda r. Right? So in this formula, 4 lambda r are constants. For a setup, 4 lambda r are constants. So what you can say there is that dn square is proportional to n. Right? So dn square is proportional to n. So if dn square is proportional to n, a graph of dn square versus n has to be a straight line. It's like the format y is equal to mx. So y is dn square and x is n. And the remaining constant m is 4 lambda r. It's a constant. Okay? So graph of dn square versus n must be a straight line as per this equation. So hence, on plotting the graph, you get a straight line like this. Next, what we do is find the slope of this line. To find the slope, what we do, we choose any two points on the line. We find the value of x1, y1, x2, y2, and then find the slope by the formula, slope is equal to y2 minus y1 upon x2 minus x1. So now in this formula, in this graph, I've used general terms over there. So here, this point, the corresponding value on the x-axis, I've taken it as n. And for this point here, the corresponding value on the x-axis is n plus p. Now, what is the meaning of this? N is a smaller number, and n plus p is a slightly bigger number. As you proceed on the graph, as you are closer to the origin, this point has a small value. This point has a slightly larger value. How do we mathematically indicate it? By putting it as n plus p, where we p is some positive number. Right? So, x-axis the values are n and n plus p. Correspondingly, on the y-axis, what are we plotting? We have plotted dn square. So if here the point has value n, the corresponding value on the y-axis will be dn square. Here, the value of the point on the x-axis is n plus p. So the corresponding on the y-axis, the point, since you are plotting dn square, on the y-axis corresponding to this point here, you are going to get the number there is dn plus p square. So then using the value of slope, what is slope? As I told you, slope formula is y2 minus y1 upon x2 minus x1. So now this is your, this point here is your x1, this point here is your x2, this point here is your y1, and this point here is your y2. So if you put these values in this formula, what are we going to get? We're going to get it as dn plus p square minus, so y2 minus y1, y1 is dn square, and x2 minus x1, it will be n plus p is x2 minus x1 is n. So n will cancel out over here, n will get it as dn plus p square dn plus p square minus dn square upon p. Now, if you look at the earlier formula which we had derived here, lambda is dn plus p square minus dn square upon p. Now, if you look at this thing here, this part over here is nothing but your slope. Dn plus p square minus dn square upon p is nothing but the slope of this graph. So, if we, in this formula, if we replace with this slope, what are we going to do with this formula change to? Lambda will become slope upon 4r. Okay, so that's how we get the formula as lambda is equal to slope upon 4r. So this is the formula in terms of an experimental graph which you are plotting. Okay, so when we do actually an experiment, we don't take diameter of only two rings, but many few rings we take diameters, plot a graph and find the value of lambda using this formula. Okay, this gives us a more accurate answer. compared to taking only two readings and calculating the value of lambda using this formula. If you know only two diameters, for example in the problem, only two values of diameters are given, you are going to use this formula for that, okay? Dn plus p square minus dn square upon 4pr. Whereas experimentally when you are doing, you have to use this formula to get a more accurate answer. This is about determining the wavelength of the monochromatic light. The next application of Newton's rings is to determine the radius of curvature of this plano convex lens which we had used there. Suppose, so any plano convex lens, suppose you have a lens which has an unknown radius, you don't know its radius, you can determine its radius by using it in the Newton's ring setup like this. For this, what has to be known to us, lambda of the source has to be known. Okay, so source wavelength is given to us. I want to find out the value of this R, radius of curvature of the lens R. So it works the same way. All you have to do is this entire derivation, this equations remain the same. Only this part over here you'll have to rearrange. R from here you'll have to take it over here, and lambda you'll have to bring down. Just interchange the positions of lambda and R, and that will give the formula for radius of curvature R. So if you just interchange this formula, what will you get? The formula for R is, so I'm not going to write the full thing again, only the final expressions I'm going to write. So we are going to determine R. What will be R as per that formula? R will be dn plus p square minus dn square upon 4p lambda. So what has done? Compared to the previous formula, we have just brought R up on the left hand side and lambda we have taken down on the right hand side. So that's how we got this formula for radius of curvature. Okay? Rest of the equations, the setup, everything remains the same. Okay, only thing, so what is given to us here is lambda is given to us, R we are calculating. And in terms of slope, what will be the formula in terms of slope? R will be equal to slope upon 4 lambda. You can see in this thing here. Here the formula was slope upon 4R. So you just interchange the positions of R and lambda, and that gives you the formula for R as slope upon 4 lambda. So the experiment remains the same. You have again have to do take readings for different diameters, plot graph, find a slope, and use this formula here, slope upon 4 lambda. Lambda is already given to you. For example, for a sodium vapor lamp, sodium light which is yellow in color, most of our Newton's rings pattern we see using this type of light, sodium vapor lamp. Its wavelength is 5893 Armstrong units. So lambda is known to us. So this is an experiment which you actually do in the lab, okay? Determining the radius of curvature of a plano convex lens using the Newton's ring setup. And this is the formula which you will be using there. R is equal to slope upon 4 lambda. Where lambda will be given to you 5893 into 10 raised to minus 10 meters. That's the wavelength of the sodium vapor lamp. So this is the second application of Newton's ring. So application 1 and 2, determination of wavelength, and second application, determination of radius, they are basically one and the same thing. Only what we have done is interchange the position of lambda and R. So if lambda is given to us, we can find R. Conversely, if R is given to us, we can find lambda. We cannot find both the things at the same time. Okay? One has to be given, other has can be determined. The third application is an important one. It's to determine the refractive index of a liquid like water or oil or glycerin, any transparent liquid. You can determine its refractive index using the Newton's ring setup. So the setup is more or less the same compared to the previous two applications. Only extra thing what you see here is there's a beaker. There's a beaker containing the liquid. So this here what you see is a beaker in which the liquid, whatever substance, let's say water, you want to find the refractive index of water. So you have to fill this beaker with that liquid so that the plano convex lens and the glass plate is submerged under this liquid. So what type of film will be there over here? There will be no longer air film. There will be a liquid film now between the lens and the glass plate. So therefore, in this formula for dn square, we can no longer put the value of mu as 1. Value of mu has to be kept as mu, the refractive index of the liquid. So this will be the only difference while calculating the refractive index of the liquid while in the derivation. We have to keep in mind that mu this time is not 1. Okay? Mu has to be kept as mu because we want to determine the value of mu. So how do we work out these things here? So initially what we do is we don't put the liquid in the beaker. So we keep the setup, everything same, the lens, everything inside the beaker. But initially in the while starting the experiment, we don't put the liquid in that beaker. So the beaker is empty. So initially, what type of film is there? This is an air film. Okay. So for the air film, what can we write there for? For air film, for the nth ring, for nth and n plus pth dark ring in reflected light, what are the formulas we can write for them in terms of the diameters? Now, since it's an air film, the value of mu is 1 initially. We have not yet put the liquid there. So, for the nth ring, what will be the formula? dn square is equal to 4n lambda r up mu. Mu is 1. And for the n plus pth ring, the formula will be dn plus p square is equal to 4 into n plus p lambda r upon 1 upon mu. So this is your equation 1 and this is your equation 2. If you subtract these two equations, you get 2 minus 1. What are we going to get there? We are going to get as dn plus p square on the left hand side minus dn square. On the right hand side, we are going to get it as again 4n lambda r, and 4n lambda r from both these equations is going to cancel out, and you are going to get it as 4p lambda r. So this is equation number 3. Okay, so this is initial part is without the liquid pour in the beaker. So it's with the air film. Next, what we are going to do is we are going to put the liquid in the beaker. So now this time there will be a liquid film between the lens and glass plate. So the film is of liquid. What is going to happen to the pattern? Whatever pattern will you see initially when there is air there, when the liquid is not yet put? You see a normal pattern consisting of alternate dark and bright circles, the Newton's rings pattern which I had shown you earlier. But now when you put the liquid, what is going to happen? Will the pattern still be there, or will it just disappear? So on putting the liquid, the pattern is still there. Okay, because what's the difference between the air and liquid film? Both are basically transparent. So there will be no much change in the pattern, appearance of the pattern. It still should be the same colored dark and bright rings. But what is going to happen to this pattern? That the rings are going to shrink. Because the pattern is going to become slightly smaller. Why? Because if you see this formula here, if you see this formula, dn square is 4n lambda upon mu. When you put a liquid, the value of, for example, let us say water. Water has a refractive index mu equal to 1.33. It's a number greater than 1. So when you put this number here greater than 1, the value of diameters are going to reduce because mu comes in the denominator. So as the value of mu keeps on increasing, the diameters keeps on decreasing. So therefore, the moment you put the liquid having refractive index mu, you're going to get a ring pattern, alternating dark and bright ring pattern. But compared to the air pattern which you had seen earlier, when you put the liquid, the rings will become smaller in size. They will have a smaller diameter. So the pattern will shrink. Okay? So so now let's run the same formulas for air film, for liquid film. So we put the liquid there in the beaker. And for the liquid film, what are the formulas we can write? For the same rings, for the same two rings, nth ring and n plus p ring, what formulas we can write? In reflected light, the formulas will be for the n3, the formula will be dn square is equal to 4n lambda r upon mu. Now this time you have to put the value of mu as mu. It's no longer 1 because it's a liquid film. And for the n plus pth film ring, n plus pth ring, the diameter of the ring will be, formula will be 4, where n is there, replace it with n plus p lambda r, again divided by mu. So let us say this is equation number that was 3, so this is 4, and this is 5. Again you subtract 5 and 4, so 5 minus 4, what does it give us? It will give us dn plus p. One more thing, for these rings, now I am going to put a dash over here. D dash n plus p, d dash n square, and d dash, so I'll just rewrite it over there. Why? I'll tell you why I'm putting the dash over there. The dash is put over there because these diameters are different. As I told you earlier, these diameters are different from the earlier diameters. So d dash n square and d dash n plus p square. What does the n indicate? N indicates diameter of the ring, nth ring or n plus pth ring in the liquid film. The diameters of the rings, same rings, the air film and liquid film are not the same, as I told you already. In liquid, the diameters become smaller. So how to differentiate them mathematically? We put a, so instead to indicate a different value of the diameter, we put a dash there, a prime. So d prime or d dash. So d dash n plus d dash n square and d dash n plus p square. These are the diameters, formula for diameters for the nth ring and n plus pth ring in a liquid film. Then on subtracting, you will get it as d dash n plus p square minus d n dash square is equal to, again what is common over here is 4n lambda r upon mu is common, it will cancel out, and what will get remaining is 4p lambda r upon mu. Okay, so this is equation number 6. Our aim is to find the value of mu, refractive index mu. So how do we do it finally? Now this is equation number 6 and we have equation number 3 here. We are going to divide these two equations. Equation 3 divided by 6. Okay? Equation 3 divided by equation 6. What are we going to get? So equation 3 divided by 6. What will you give us? On the left hand side, we are going to get d n plus p square minus d n square divided by, so this is the left hand side of equation number 3 and divided by the left hand side of equation number 6. So d n plus p dash square minus d n dash square is equal to, on the right side, what are we going to get? So we are going to divide this part, here, 4p lambda r, we are going to divide it by 4p lambda r upon mu. So 4p lambda r is going to cancel out, and what we are going to get it is 1 divided by 1 by mu, which is mu. You can work it out and see. So on dividing the left hand side of equation 3 and 6, the right hand side, only what will be remaining is mu. Okay, so this is the formula which we are interested in. We want to calculate the refractive index of the liquid. And that's the formula then. Dn plus p square minus dn square upon d dash n plus p square minus dn square. So, to calculate the refractive index, what are you going to need? You're going to need values of four diameters. Two diameters in air film. So that will be dn and dn plus p. And two diameters in a liquid film, once you put the liquid in the beaker. So that will be d dash n and d dash n plus p. So with this four diameters, two in air and two in liquid, you can calculate the value of refractive index mu of the liquid. So this is how the applications of Newton's rings: to determine refractive index, to determine radius of curvature, and to determine the wavelength of the monochromatic source of light. So with this, we end this chapter on interference of light. So in this chapter, we have initially studied about parallel film and obtained the conditions for maxima and minima. Then we worked on interference in a wedge-shaped film. What was able to derive a formula for expression for fringe width, and we used it to determine the thickness of a thin object. And the last thing what we did in this chapter was the Newton's rings film and its applications, which we have just studied. Thank you. With this, the chapter of interference ends.